Hi, I'm Dr. Jan Basile from the Medical University of South Carolina and the VA hospitals in Charleston, South Carolina. And I'm here at the 2017 American Heart Association Council on Hypertension, Kidney Council, and the American Society of Hypertension meeting. And it is my pleasure to have Dr. Josh Samuels with us. Josh is from the McGovern School of Medicine at the University of Texas in Houston. Josh, welcome.
Thank you.
And we are here to talk about the very important recently released pediatric guideline on hypertension, which is 13 years in the making since the last one in 2004. Josh was on the writing committee, is actively involved in the treatment of hypertension as a nephrologist, and we are delighted that he's going to help us better understand this update in pediatric hypertension. So Josh, let me ask you, a first question, if I may, why was this new guideline necessary?
Well, Jan, you sort of answered that in your introduction to me. The most recent guidelines that we had before these came out were published back in 2004, and so they were getting a little long in the tooth. And the number of publications that have come out in the past 12 years and the amount of information that we've learned about how to evaluate and how to treat high blood pressure in children really made these new guidelines necessary.
Very good. I understand the evidence base is greatly expanded in pediatric hypertension, so there are key evidence-based key points for the clinician. Can you just discuss that a little bit?
Absolutely. We used evidence-based literature search with PICO questions, and as you mentioned, evaluated over 15,000 articles that had been published between 2004 and 2015. And the new guidelines incorporate the American Academy of Pediatrics metric for quality of evidence and quality of and strength of recommendation based on the quality of evidence that we have. And through our literature review, the committee came up with 30 key action statements, complete with a risk and harm and benefit ratio, particular patients excluded from the guidelines, and each key action statement lists the references that were used to come up with those guidelines. In addition, there were a number of areas where the committee thought that we needed to make a statement where there wasn't enough evidence, and so there are 27 additional recommendations in the new guidelines that do not reach the level of being key action statements.
Very good. So published in Pediatrics from the American Academy of Pediatrics, tell us what is new, the key points, the most important points, because we can't talk about the whole document, but what comes to your mind about the key differences?
Well, as we've said, we really tried to update the evidence base for our recommendations. The main differences that people will see in the new guidelines, first of all, we've really simplified the definition of what hypertension is in children and adolescents. We've come up with a simplified blood pressure table. The original fourth report tables were very cumbersome to use. You had to know the child's height percentile before you could look. And the new tables, first of all, we exclude any child who is overweight or obese from that normal blood pressure table. And so we've corrected what I think was an error in the original fourth report tables. But even simpler than having the new tables, we have a simplified screening table that just by age and gender tells pediatricians and primary care providers of children what blood pressure they need to worry about and when they need to even go to those tables. We've also updated the recommendations for the evaluation of hypertension once it's been defined to include a lot more emphasis on 24-hour ambulatory blood pressure monitoring.
So what are some of the differences then in the treatment of hypertension? Anything new there?
Well, I think we've made it clear that because so much hypertension in children and adolescents these days is primary hypertension, the new guidelines have a key action statement that recommends therapeutic lifestyle modification, so treatment with diet and exercise, as a first-line agent for any child who's developed high blood pressure. The guidelines do go on to talk about specific treatment recommendations as far as antihypertensive medications are concerned, and they also list new and frankly lower blood pressure goals for targets of therapy, whether you're using pharmacologic treatment or therapeutic lifestyle modification. And so again, the new data supports these lower blood pressure thresholds.
So you talk about the importance of ABPM to eliminate white coat to get the better measurement. What about office blood pressure? Where does that fit in?
Well, we still define hypertension based on office blood pressure in pediatrics. Not a single reading, and the guidelines talk about how you need multiple readings within a visit. You also need multiple readings across several office visits before you're able to make the diagnosis. In young children, younger than 13, we still use percentile-based definitions for what is too high or where the cut points for elevated blood pressure and hypertension occur. For teens and adolescents and older children, we now have static cut points for what the definition is of high blood pressure. And so the definition is still based off of office blood pressure readings. But as you mentioned, because white coat hypertension is such a common finding in children with high blood pressure, the first part of the workup, once you've determined that a child has elevated or high blood pressure, is to confirm that with an ambulatory blood pressure monitoring with out-of-office readings.
And in the past, you've recommended echocardiography of the heart, perhaps renal ultrasound. Where do those tests fit in now in this new guideline?
Given the changing epidemiology of primary hypertension in children and adolescents, we've really streamlined the workup of blood pressure once it's found. We still do an evaluation for secondary causes, and so you'll still see the need to do renal ultrasounds in patients who are at risk, doing histories, physicals, blood tests, and again, the guidelines contain all of those recommendations. You specifically mentioned echocardiogram, which is, of course, a very expensive part of the evaluation of a child or adolescent with high blood pressure. And the new guidelines have made significant changes from the fourth report. We're now only recommending an echocardiogram at the time that the clinician is considering starting pharmacologic therapy. So for those first 6 months that we're treating with therapeutic lifestyle modifications, since that's going to be the treatment anyways, there's no need to do that expensive echocardiogram right at the time of diagnosis. We've also changed our treatment threshold so that we're really treating to a blood pressure threshold, not to an echocardiogram threshold. And so there's much less of an emphasis on repeated echocardiograms in children and adolescents with hypertension.
So we've talked about why the document was necessary. We've talked about some of the things, what's new in the document. Do you see any obstacles in getting what you have written in the document accomplished in clinical practice?
Well, again, from the beginning, we really tried to write a set of guidelines that was going to make it easier on the primary care providers to make the diagnosis of hypertension and to begin the evaluation of high blood pressure. I still recognize that the recommendation to use ambulatory blood pressure monitoring may be difficult because it's not always available in many of these primary care settings. And that's something that as a community we're going to have to work on, making this a more usable and available technique. Beyond that, again, we've really tried to make the blood pressure table simpler. We've tried to make the definitions or the cut points easier to use. And so we're really hoping that primary care providers are have a much easier time recognizing abnormally high blood pressure in children and adolescents.
Well, Josh, I want to thank you very much. It's been a great session just talking with you, updating our audience. And I want to thank you as well for joining us today at the 2017 meeting.
Thank you so much.